Welcome to our presentation. We are going to show you how to leak data from a Fitbit and how to modify data that comes out of a Fitbit. This is Daniel, and
Hi.
He works in the same group as me. And I'm Jiska. And that's the outline for today. So we will start with some system overview, the end-to-end protocol between the server and the Fitbit. We will continue with the hardware access and then also show the wireless protocol. And in the end, we have a very nice demo for you. Nobody has seen this before. We did responsible disclosure with Fitbit. They are very nice guys. So everything we present today, they know that we present this. And we also present a bit of other research from other research groups. So I will start with the system overview. You will always have a tracker and a server, which use end-to-end encryption. And this encryption is symmetric, so you have this device-specific key on the tracker and also on the server, which is equal for both, but for each tracker they have another key, of course. And on top of this end-to-end encryption, you will have some Bluetooth LE, which is not secured, so this is marked red. And there is some HTTPS, and it's always being forwarded via an application. So this means you have this end-to-end encryption, some other stuff on top, but you cannot really do something on a first view. There's... Who? Ah, okay. So what you normally do is you have the tracker, and this is Susie Fit. She runs every day, very long, and all her activity is stored on her tracker. And the memory of the tracker will be full after a week or so, and normally she should synchronize more often, so each 16 minutes you have something called a megadump. There's also a microdump, which is not used for this, but there's the megadump that we now use to send this activity data, and the server response then says to the Fitbit to delete the data that was transferred to the server, but also some more things like the user settings, like a stride length, for example. So the stride length is needed to calculate the distance and display it on the tracker and so on. So the server settings get applied and the server can decrypt the megadump to actually get the data from the tracker. And this is still not really helping Susie because she has some Fitbit Flex without any display, so she does not see anything of this happening, but she can use the smartphone app. And the smartphone app is then requesting some JSON summaries from the server, and this is human readable, and it's displayed in the app, and it's already decrypted by the server. There is an open source tool, Galileo, which actually does all this forwarding for you. So all this stuff is known up to the point that the tracker and the server can communicate and can save data, but if Susie wants to get the data from her tracker, she actually needs to connect to the server via the official web interface. And now I'm going to talk a little bit more about this end-to-end protocol magic between the tracker and the server. So when we started our research, we bought many trackers on eBay and so on, used ones, and well, it happened we had an unencrypted one. So this is not standard behavior, but they exist. And this exists for models between 2015, as it turned out, during responsible disclosure and so on, so the newer ones will hopefully never be in plain text, but this one was. So we could observe this megadump and megadump response in plain text. And the man in the middle attack was also possible to read the JSON contents, so we could actually see it all. And this is where we started the research. So this is a plain text megadump, a short one. They can get really long, up to a week of data. And you ask yourself, what is in there? So you see many zeros, it's obviously not encrypted. Then you might see some ASCII text, even for the Fitbit Flex, this one is sent. It has no display, normally it should be displayed on a display like on the Fitbit One, but not on Fitbit Flex. Then you see some numbers that repeat and increase, which are timestamps. It's a 4-byte format, reverse byte order, Unix timestamp in seconds. And then there is one which is not reverse byte order for whatever reason. And then you ask yourself, what is the actual data that is transmitted? So you have some stuff, but you don't understand the remaining shit. So what was happening here? Then we looked into our man-in-middle proxy records, and then you see, okay, you ask for some data, and then you have this synchronization a bit later, and later on you will ask again for the same data, and then you can compare what happened between two timestamps and the megadump in between. And in the JSON, you will see some stuff like the activity steps, so that's the steps for the complete day until the current time, as well as for each minute a step count, so there's many zeros in there starting at midnight and then each minute a zero until you did something. And we use this to further reverse engineer the format. So what you can see here, for example, so this is this, there's this last timestamp, and after the last timestamp, there's some summaries, and there is this step count summary. So 43 hex is the same as the 67 here, so we could match this. And then we continued with the step count, so over here you can see the timestamp, which is the same timestamp as here in the JSON file. There was no activity, 2 minutes, and then 14 steps, 35, 18, and so on. And you can see the same pattern here. So, I mean, there are some other bytes again in between, but each 4 bytes, there is a step count. So this was the basis for us to understand the protocol. So part by part, you can further understand what is in there just by sniffing. And then we had the idea, okay, let's try to modify this. So what we did there was just the lazy approach. Okay, we understood how step counts work. Let's just replace by the maximum amount of steps. And to do this, you can modify the Galileo code. You can write some man-in-the-middle proxy script and even more things, whatever you want to do. And then the server said, well, this is nice, but I expected another checksum. And it even replies the checksum, so it says, I want a checksum ABCD. So the question is, where do I find a checksum? Well, F7, that's the actual packet length in the end. So where could be the checksum? 1, 2, 3, 4, yeah, that's the checksum. So what we did, we replaced this. And the server says, oh, I'm happy with this. I take all your data. Sadly, this has been fixed, so you can no longer do this. I mean, it's a pretty easy server-side patch, but it helped us in the beginning to understand how things work and also to verify that we really had the correct fields and so on. And then there is the next thing. So Susie might not be as lucky as us. She might not get an unencrypted plaintext tracker on eBay. But the good thing here is if she creates this dump in plain text and it's correct, the server would just accept it. So despite everything is encrypted, she just takes the serial number. The serial number is still in plain text even in the encrypted dump because the server needs to match the correct key and you can only do this with the serial number. You take this one, you do the rest, the remaining data, you just do it in plain text and then the server says, yes, I'm happy. The sad news is... this has also been fixed. We will tell you about the bug fix of this later. Yeah, but at least so. Let's say we have this thing and it's all in plain text. Then we could live without a server, right? So you have this mega dump. You did understand the mega dump. You can interpret your data. Everything is nice, and you just now need to emulate the server responses. And there is someone on the Galileo mailing list who was really keen into getting all these fields from the megadump response format. And it's really required to send a response, because without any response from the server, the local storage will be full after a week, data will never be deleted, and you also have problems. For example, there are some features that you can only configure within a megadump response. And what the guy found out is really, let's say, everything. So there's user properties, like the stride length and so on. There's display features, so which format you use to display things. You can set alarms to wake someone up at a certain time. You can delete data, set the current day, time, set daily goals and so on. So it's all there. And the next interesting finding the person had was, so he had a Fitbit Flex and he was never directly talking to the server. And he said, sometimes my Fitbit is switching to encrypted mode, and then the server is sending something in encrypted. But as soon as I send something in plain text instead, so a valid mega dump response in plain text, my tracker will be plain text again. So this sounds very nice. We tried this and we did not succeed. So it was a bit strange in the beginning, like, why could he do this? Why is he so confident that this works and so on? And we did some firmware reverse engineering later and we found out like there's at least three encryption states which are compared and so on. So there's a bit more magic in this. And during responsible disclosure, it turned out it's a bit more complicated. So there's trial encryption. Trial encryption means like, well, you have all these unencrypted trackers and you want to migrate them to be encrypted, but you don't know if it works. So it might work, maybe, and maybe not. So what the tracker does is it tries to send an encrypted megadump to the server from time to time. The server then replies with a message and says, let's do encryption and so on, just encrypt it. And the tracker locks it down to encryption. So the tracker then, if you send something in plain text, will always reply with some error code. So it says encryption required if you look a bit into the app. Okay, so the tracker requires encryption. And the next problem is the server will also, and this is the bug fix for this attack that I have shown previously, the server will remember encrypted trackers. So this is really the important part. The tracker will know the server will know that your tracker is encrypted, and if you send something in plain text with a valid CRC, the tracker will not accept this. So this is pretty sad, because this means this whole thing with the server independence does not work anymore for encrypted trackers. So all the things that Danny was finding, it's not really possible anymore unless you find a plain text tracker. So this is the sad news, but now let's look into the hardware.
I'm not sure if I have better news, but so Jiska talked about this whole, let's move the mouse so that the screensaver is not active. Jiska talked about this complete protocol of the Fitbit ecosystem, basically. But What we was also interested in was the hardware itself. So what can we do if we have access to the hardware? So the first question is, what is our threat model in this case? So again, we have our Susie Fit. She stores her data locally. She, of course, owns the tracker, which is, as we already heard, secured with a device-specific key. Now, if Susie has some malicious intents, she can have different goals. So first of all, she might want to access her own data, which is stored on the tracker, maybe modify it. So as we already heard from Jiska, the data is only synchronized every 16 minutes. So it has to be saved somewhere on the tracker. And yeah, she might want to get access to it. And another thing which would be interesting is to get access to these encryption keys. So as we heard, there are encrypted trackers and she might want to decrypt the data which is sent to the server. So first things first, we need to tear down our tracker. A short tip, if you want to do it by yourself, use a heat gun. About 200 degrees is good enough. Then you can basically just plug out the PCB from its casing. So instead of using some Dremel or something, just use a heat gun. It works just better. And so this is what your tracker might look like before, and this is what ours look like after. So there are some pieces missing, but it still works, no problem. So next interesting thing is what we saw when we looked at the PCB, there are many, many test points on this. So this probably means that there is some debug functionality. So you might want to know what these debug pins are good for. And the first thing to get this is look up the data sheet of the microcontroller which is used on the Fitbit. So in our case, this is from STM. And STM provides excellent documentation, free for all on the internet. This is really great for reverse engineering. And in this, you can also find a pinout, which basically tells you exactly which pins on the MCU are responsible, for example, for debugging. And next thing you have to do is to desolder your MCU. This very likely breaks your Fitbit because you won't be able to resolder it, except you have excellent equipment, but if not, you won't be able to solder it back on, basically. Then, once you have desoldered the MCU from the PCB, you can just use a simple multimeter to verify which pin is actually, basically which pin of the MCU comes out on the testing pins. And if you know that, you can just solder some jumper wires on the testing points and you're good to go. Next thing is you need to connect it to a debugger. So we chose to use the SPW protocol because it only needs two wires and an additional ground pin, and also a reset pin would be nice. And we also used the debugger which is provided by ST-Link, by STM. It's called ST-Link. I also will show you it later. And it's really cheap. It's a hardware debugger, but it comes for about 20 bucks on eBay. After this, if we, in the end, we set everything up and we saw that we can read and write arbitrary memory, which is already really nice. But what we quickly discovered after that is that we are not able to run, for example, GDB on it, because in after you reach a certain point in the execution, the debug pins are used for other stuff. So your debugger will just disconnect. Okay, so what does the memory actually look like? So it looks like this. You have some flash memory for the firmware code, and you also have some EEPROM for stuff which should survive an empty battery, and you also have some RAM. So you need some RAM for placing your variables which should be accessible during runtime. So you might wonder why does it not start at zero? This is basically just a boot up configuration. Here in this case, this 8 million hex is just alias, basically for zero. So if we now look, have a closer look at the EEPROM, we can first note that we do not really need to understand what's going on in the flash or what the firmware code is doing. Because as Jiska already told you, we already know what the firmware dumps looks like, and we can expect to find similar things in the EEPROM. So we had a closer look at this, and the first thing you see is the serial ID and the encryption key, and some strange bytes, which I will tell you about later. After this, You find some user settings. So this is what you get from the server. So for example, some alarm settings, and most importantly, the activity records, of course, in plain text. So this is already pretty nice. So now, I already told you we can read and write memory, and we know where the activity records are. So what is the next logical thing for a hacker to do? Of course, modify it. So we just placed the biggest amount of steps into the memory, synchronized our Fitbit back with our app, and it also synchronized just fine with the server and internet. And then you see something like this. So one day, 60 million steps is pretty good result, I would say. And so for fixing this on Fitbit side, the easiest thing I would say is to just disable the debugging completely. So this would be the last step in production, just debugging, disable the debugging completely. Yeah, but what actually happens is that now the server does some plausibility checks. So maybe 16 million steps are not that easy to get. But one has also to note that it, Fitbit never really considers the user as a threat. So why would they leave debugging on if they would not consider this? Okay, so let's look at some more stuff at the EEPROM. So we still don't know. So Iskra already told you there are two modes. The Fitbit can be encrypted and can be unencrypted, but there must be some memory where this is saved, or which the Fitbit uses to distinguish if it's encrypted or not. And I already told you that we know where the serial number is and where the pre-share key is. So we already know everything which is needed for encryption. And as it turns out, the strange byte in between the serial number and the keys, one of them is actually responsible for encryption. So if you set the byte on 1, your tracker is encrypted. If you set it on 0, your tracker is unencrypted, which is pretty nice to have. So the problem is, if your Fitbit was once encrypted and talked to the server, as Jessica told you, the server now remembers that you once talked to the server encrypted, and if you now switch back the Fitbit to unencrypted mode by flipping this byte, it won't actually accept your connection anymore. So this is kind of fixed, I guess. So Jessica will tell you more about the wireless protocol.
Yeah, so the hardware access, it's very powerful, but the question is, what can we do with the wireless protocol? And people looked a bit deeper into this, and it's really nice what you can do there. So you have this Galileo implementation, which is synchronizing your tracker. And basically, it's using some Bluetooth variant of communication where you just have 20 byte frames, and a frame can either be a command starting with C0, or it's not starting with C0, then it's data, and it's being escaped if the data would, in theory, start with C0. There is many commands that are issued by Galileo, and even more which are used by the normal app. So in the very beginning for communication, you are initializing this air link. Then you have this get megadump microdump thing. Then you can also receive the megadump response. And then it gets interesting. So there is authentication. And then there are authenticated commands. And I'm going to show you one authenticated command that already has been found before. So first of all, we need to do authentication. So you have the user who logs in. So Susie Fit is logging in into her account. And there is this local pairing, which anyone can do. And based on this, they are doing some associations. So Susie wants to have in her Fitbit account listed this Fitbit Flex. And during this association here, there is, for the Fitbit Flex, there is some tapping, so she needs to physically tap her tracker. And if she has a tracker with display, she has to enter a pin shown on her display. So this is done for the association. On local pairing, there is no security measure. This whole thing is just on top. And after doing this, if you have this associated account, you can ask for authentication credentials. So you cannot just ask for any authentication credentials for any tracker, just for associated trackers. And these authentication credentials, they are stored on the app. And then the app can issue authenticated commands. So this is again marked in red because except from the authentication credentials, there's not really security, which I'm going to show now. So you have all these three parties, the tracker, the app, the server. And the server has this device key. And together with the device key and a nonce, it's creating a subkey, which is the authentication key. The server is sending the authentication credentials, which are this authentication key and the nonce, to the app, and the app is storing this. So this is permanently stored on the app after this request. And now the app needs to authenticate to the tracker. So the app wants to prove I'm being operated by Susie Fit because I once was using her login and so on, and there's this association and so on and so forth. So what they do is they do a comparison. So this is mutual. They want to check that each of them has the authentication key, or the tracker can generate the authentication key, and all they need to transfer for this is the nonce. So they never actually transmit this authentication key. And as you see, they also, between server and tracker, they never transmit the device key. So this is kept secure. And now you can tamper a bit with this. So in your application, you have the authentication credentials, and for each authentication, the app just chooses any random number. And then, in sending the command 50, the random number and the nonce, the tracker is then calculating from the nonce the same authentication key as in the authentication credentials here, does some CMAC, and sends a challenge with a counter, and then there is the response, which depends on the counter. So this is really, it's mutual, and there's only the CMAC of the authentication key which is transferred and not the authentication key itself. So this looks quite secure, but this nonce is not really a nonce, so it can be used as often as you want. So you once have authentication credentials, you can always use authentication credentials, and they depend on the device key, which is never exchanged. So even if Susie says her tracker on Fitbit, the authentication credentials still are valid. Not so nice, but this is actually by design. So there is more authenticated commands which really need this design that the app has locally these authentication credentials and is reusing them without any server interaction. And the next part is you can just have some man in the middle attack and you get these authentication credentials and you can use them forever. So you just do the attack once and that's it. Now there is a nice authenticated command which has been revealed previously. So the person revealing this had a charge HR and compared a firmware update. So there has been a firmware update for the charge HR and he compared just two versions, located the difference, and he just found there was one command being fixed and it was no longer there, the command number 11. And then he tried to find out what this command is doing, and it's a memory request, so you can request any address and the length, and then you get many of these 20-byte frames back. And the nice part is, so even if you don't know the addresses, you either get an empty response or you will get, so for example, if the length is too long, then it will just stopping the output at some point, but it just works. You can request the memory. And we have also discovered, so before the charge HR, there has been the Fitbit 1 and Fitbit Flex, and for this, this has never been fixed. So if you own one of these old devices, you can actually read out your encryption key. But after authentication, I mean, it's a bit limited. You really need the authentication credentials and so on. So it's easy to do for a tracker that you own. It's not so easy to do for any tracker, and it's only for the older models. But if you want to be server independent, this is pretty nice. So you read the encryption key here, you become server independent, or you could even fake again with this encryption key this mega dump. So because Martin, who did this, he also submitted some code to Galileo that you can actually decrypt data and so on, so the encryption has been understood. And so there is nothing really stopping you for these old trackers. And now we also have something fancy to show you, because Daniel, he's our reverse engineering expert and the guy who does the all the stuff with firmware modification, and he did nice things.
Yeah. Okay. We already told you that we can read and write arbitrary equations on the firmware. You might ask yourself, but can we also edit what the code is actually doing on the Fitbit itself, so the actual firmware code? So, and you might also have seen my talk last year on the MRMCD, where I talked about the NextMon project. And with the NextMon project, we modified firmware on Wi-Fi chips of the, for example, Nexus 5. And as turns out, this is just another ARM chip, and we can adapt NextMon to this new platform, and we are good to go. And now I will show you what we can actually do with it. So first of all, before I actually show you the demo, this is our current setup. It might look a bit crude, but it just works fine. This is the ST-Link connector, which you use for reading and writing memory. So it just has an USB output here. And on the other side, we have also USB, but it's just powering the Fitbit, nothing less, more or less. So the rest of the connectors are just used for connecting the debugger. Okay, that's basically just it from the hardware side. And now we can maybe switch back to the slides or my laptop. Okay. Okay, so what I will show you right now is basically a little modification of the Galileo framework, which Jiska told you before, and I have to enter my password. Okay, and what will happen now is that we send a custom command to the Fitbit, and in case it works, it will show you some nice ASCII art. Okay. So, thank you. This is basically the command which we sent to the Fitbit. Of course, we used 42. And here are two things important. So, we do not just substitute some strings in the firmware. no, we are actually capable of modifying the program flow. And also another thing, Jiska told you before that there are some more powerful commands which you needs authentication. For my command, I didn't need any authentication.
So something you might also see here, so for the people who look really what is there, so we are using the memory dump command, but it's without authentication, so that's why you have this thing in here. So we write something into a selected memory area, memcopy, blah, 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 and then we have this nice output here. So it's basically, it's an unauthenticated memory dump.
Okay, back to the bit defect slides. Give me a minute. No, not from the beginning. So, okay, this looks better. Yes. So we showed you this demo. Then some final slides. We also do some advertisement for our own research group. So we are the Secure Mobile Networking Research Group. And if you come to the dark side or orange side in our case, you will get cake. And also we have some topics for you in case you are looking for some master theses or bachelor theses, or you want to do some heavy stuff either for credits or for money. It doesn't care, we take everyone. So that's it from our side. Thank you. Questions? Yes. Yeah. Okay, sorry.
Thank you. It might be because I didn't really know about this Fitbit stuff at all, but I'm a bit confused about the threat model here. So why is it a vulnerability that you can change your counter? Is anyone relying on the Fitbit giving you the correct step size? Can you earn money by making steps or something?
Yes. So you can earn money. There is some reward programs, and there is, I mean, I guess not in Germany, but at least in the US, there is health insurances which like to see that you do fitness. So this is the intention why the user is suddenly becoming the attacker. So in the beginning, Fitbit never thought, like, why should you lie to the server? So, I mean, you just want to do some sports, and you want to have your records, and why should you change this? But now there is this stuff on top, so you can make money by doing this. Yeah.
So also the end-to-end encryption. I mean, my phone has probably a TLS connection to the server. So why would I care about having an end-to-end encryption? It's also against this threat model. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's actually okay. One of the reasons, and it's also that the protocol is. Well, I mean, they want to be in there. They want to get your data, and they will not get your data if there's open source software. Any more questions? I mean, it was a lot of technical details, so yep, there is one more question.
You said that the server introduced sanity checks for the number of steps now. Have you tried messing around like a bit with the sanity checks? Like what is the most insane amount of steps you can take that still passes the sanity check?
No, we didn't do this, but we did other stuff, And it's really annoying right now to hack Fitbit because you just send one or two packets not having the correct CRC or did something in the wrong order and then you are blocked. So what has been easy back then is now really, really annoying. It's not that it's not working anymore, but it's just harder.
Has there been a special reason why you choose Fitbit? As I think the French manufacturer of things that was sold to Nokia in the early times has also a good tracking system and an app and was more inside this before Fitbit came up. What was your intention about choosing Fitbit?
Yeah, so back when we did this, Fitbit was the market leader. There's now also some other big companies like Xiaomi. But for everything that is not really like Apple Watch or something, something that is just a tracker, Fitbit really was the market leader and the only really big player back then. So I mean, there's many other companies offering trackers. So and then yes, there's a second reason. So by the other group that we cite there has been a study where they compared 17 other trackers. And those trackers did not have any security. So it was just plain text. So Man in the Middle was sufficient to break them. So that's a bit boring. So let's say Fitbit has good security. So they really care about this. They have a nice responsible disclosure team and so on.
Is there any chance to develop a custom firmware that cracks up the server side boundaries so that you can store your data on your own server that you set up at home?
As yes.
This is the thing yes. that we are all thinking about if we are talking about trackers that we want to keep safe the data.
So as I said, so the encryption is understood so far. Then you have the part that you can modify the firmware as we have shown. So you can exchange the encryption key, you could even exchange the encryption algorithm to something more secure, and you could use an independent server, but only for those older models. So it's let's say not so easy for the newer ones and so on, so maybe it's also impossible, you don't know, but for the old ones, yeah.
Thank you very much.
There's one more question. There. Actually, two more questions. So we need to walk a lot here.
Is it actually desirable to have reliable fitness trackers in a cryptographic mean? Because you said they're used for insurances and that's all that kind that's maybe unethical or not very intelligent to pursue because it is a trade-off for the end user in respect of his privacy and insurance companies.
Well, you will save money if you are a healthy person. But yeah, for the standard nerd, there might not be the incentive to do so. So it's really crazy what some people are doing out there just to save some money. Yeah. I mean, so for the newer trackers, you also have more data like the heart rate and so on and better sensors. The newest one even has oxygen stuff. So people want to measure themselves and people want to show other people that they are healthy. Does this answer your question, or is it?
Yeah.
Okay. There was one question down here.
How exactly did you load the modified firmware onto the controller?
This is just the standard STM stuff. So, I mean, yes, there is more ways to do this, but we do not show this here. So there will be more, but so for now the way is to open the hardware. Yeah. So yes, there is more to come, but we will not show this now. Okay, then thank you.